As we're allowing people to pile in here this morning, what I wanted to do is just give you all just a quick, brief synopsis of my books, because some of you all may be familiar with them, some of you may not. You know, we are in the midst of the Publishing in Color conference co-hosted by Talk Publishing with Jolanda Rogers. And you know, it's just been making me think more about my books. And so I just want to let you all know, this is Fresh Baked Manna. Put this in front of you. This is volume one. You can get this one on Amazon.com. It's 90 Days of Wisdom from the Word of God. And if you have Fresh Baked Manna, what I would love for you to do is go out and write me a review on it if it's been a blessing to your life. But this is Fresh Baked Manna, volume one, 90 Days of Wisdom from the Word of God. And then we have Fresh Baked Manna, volume two, more days of wisdom from God's word. And these books are not designed to replace God's word. They're designed to be an addendum to the word of God. They're a supplement to God's word to help you get to the word every day. I share testimonials, practical life situations, because to me, if what you're living in your walk with Christ doesn't translate to something that, you know, all these scriptures and all of this stuff, if you can't take that stuff and apply it to your everyday life, as I've said in times gone by, it's worthless. But thank God we can. We can take the word and live the word out in our everyday life, because that's how God intended for it to be. That's how he wants it to be in your life. And so that's what Fresh Baked Manna is. It's a daily devotional that'll help you. And then we have what we call the Practical Life Series, or the Life Series books. And these are seven little books, you know, that will help build your life and your faith. You know, we've got different topics in here like fearless faith and, you know, hold fast to your confession of faith, authority and the faith factor. I love this one. Faith to be a kingdom woman, for those of you that are women. And then we've got preparation time is never wasted time. You know, I've shared these with you all before, but this is the Faith Life series. And then there's a bunch of them, and they're designed to help develop your life. And then there's the little black books. You know, I made them little black books for a reason, because these, you know, move into more than just your everyday life. It's those who work on themselves. You need to work on yourself. Those who walk with God. This is wisdom for those who serve other people. What do you need to know when it comes to serving other people? And then those who love other people. All of these little books will help you. They're quick little reads, you know, as you're going throughout your day. You know, you get a moment to sit down, woosah, take something in to build yourself. That's what these books are designed to do. They're designed to develop your life and your faith. We've got a bunch of other books that are coming out. We're going to be putting out the Love Life series very soon, as well as, you know, we're working on some things from a major publishing company. And so you just keep me in prayer, because God is doing some things. Let's get into our topic this morning. If you're interested in how you can get our books, you can go to melvahenderson.org and you can place your order for books, and we'll get them right out to you. We're talking about faith for the family. You know, and we talked yesterday about the importance of communication, and, you know, one of the reasons it's important to be a person in your family who's committed to communicating. You know, I had my husband on and he was sharing some really powerful things, and I appreciate his perspective. But why do we need to communicate in our families? Number one, so that we can reach understandings. You need to know where everybody is coming from in your family. Sometimes one of the bigger blocks to communication is, I don't know where you stand. I don't know where you're coming from. And where did you get that perception from? Why would you think that way? It's because we always have this elephant in the room, because nobody wants to communicate. And it's an essential, critical part of developing our relationships with one another. I was talking to the people on our prayer line this morning, and I was saying to them, God wants you to be able to have healthy conflicts in your relationships, but he doesn't want you to end the relationship because you're having healthy conflicts. And I'm sorry, believers don't know how to have healthy conflict. You know, I've been a pastor I was an associate pastor for 17 years, but I've been a senior pastor for 15 years, and I'm just convinced Church people don't know how to have conflict because they think, oh, the love of God is supposed to be involved in everything we do. It is involved in everything we do, but that doesn't mean that we don't have conflict with one another. And it doesn't mean that we're not going to have situations that we're going to have to walk through. But because people are immature emotionally, they haven't learned how to be able to be in a relationship with people, even though there's a fallout. You either act out emotionally or you act out to such a degree that people are like, you know what? I don't need this, you know, and here's the crazy thing is some people don't realize when you're in your relationships with your family, you can have these dysfunctional relationships in your family. And in your family unit, it's normal to be dysfunctional inside the context of your family unit. But you take that dysfunction outside of the family unit and somebody gonna knock you upside your head. I'm sorry, I'm saying it. You know, you can't assume that people that are outside of your family context are going to be okay with the things that you're able to get away with inside the family context. It's not going to happen because everybody doesn't see the world the way that you see it and the way that your family sees it. And so it's important for you to realize that you have to learn how to develop these healthy communications with one another so that you can be productive in the world. Inside the family is where you learn how to communicate with the rest of the world. And if that the communication within the family is broken down, that's the foundation. If your communication with the family is broken down, you better believe you're going to have a challenge communicating with other people. You know, I'm always amazed at how people inside the family think that they're going to be able to get into relationships with other people and have these really flourishing, flowing relationships. Well, here's the problem. You take you with you. And if you have not learned how to engage with people in times of conflict and disagreement, what you are, who you are, you take that into every relationship that you have. So it's really important that you learn inside the family unit how to deal, because inside the family is like, I could do it maybe legally, but I can't divorce you from being my sister or my brother. Really, I mean, I could say that, you know, I'm cutting off communication, but in reality, my bloodline speaks heavier and deeper than any other kind of connection. And so it is really important that we learn with those that are in our bloodline that can't get away from us, that captive relationships, inside those captive relationships, that we learn how to be the best communicator in our relationships. The other reason that we need to communicate is so we can solve problems. A lot of issues among family members arise because of miscommunication. And again, coming together to talk about a particular problem, it'll open the lines of communication so that you all can find solutions to what's negatively affecting you, what's negatively affecting the family. And then another reason is so you can end gossip. You know, family members love to talk about one another. They love to call sister so-and-so, brother, the brother, the cousin, the aunt, the uncle, the mother, the grandmother, and talk about other people. And sometimes the details of topics can be misconstrued. You know, there's that saying that you can say something, person number one can say something, but by the time it gets to person number five, it's a whole different story. Why is that? Because people add things to things that they want to see in there. And sometimes we miscommunicate, misconstrue things because we want it to be juicier, you know? And unfortunately, what we end up doing and we don't realize is we tear down people's character. We impact people's lives. You know, you can say something about, I was reading this book that I bought in Israel many years ago. It's called Hashalaron or something like that. And the book is outstanding because it talks about how we need to be careful of our words, because you can say something about somebody to somebody else and you can make what you're saying true in the mind of that person, and that person may not have ever met them. You know, so you got to be careful with what you're saying, because when you're communicating and you're misconstruing things and the family is gossiping, by the time it's been passed down through the grapevine, facts are no longer facts. And going to the family member, you know, people are talking about one another and talking about the situation is a great way to open communication, you know, in a negative way. But we want to talk and communicate so that we can keep communicating in a positive way, so that we can move away from giving people the wrong impression of situations. You know, the other reason that it's important to communicate is because it encourages support. You know, a family system is so critical and so vital to your life. And the family system helps every one of the members in that family through difficult times, through bad times. And when a family communicates well, everybody understands what love with another person in that family will need. And so you make it better for people to be able to support one another. Even if nothing can be done about the situation, just providing that listening ear and being there can make the difference in somebody else's life, you know? And so these things are really important as you're thinking about your family and where your families are. So communicating is key. It's the number one key to making sure that your family stays strong. I'm convinced that one of the reasons adultery and different things begin happening in marriage is because there is a breakdown somewhere in communication. You know, when there's a breakdown in communication, we're not looking eye to eye anymore. And see, when I can look in your eye, I can tell when something in your life has shifted. It's like, what's going on? You're not looking me eye to eye anymore. What's going on in your life? What's going on that we're not connecting like we used to connect? What's happening? And see, when you get away from communicating with the people that you love and walking closely with them, being able to keep your finger on the pulse and the spiritual climate of your household, then things start happening and little foxes start creeping in and spoiling the vine. And before you know it, you've got this massive issue and you're trying to figure out, how did we get here? What's going on? It's because somewhere you have been failing to communicate with one another, you know, and communication is a critical key. It's a key to intimacy in family members, not just marriage, but it's a key to intimacy. It's what keeps me close to my children. It's what keeps me close to my mother. You know, my mother can go into her house. My mother can be in her house for days and never say a word. None of us, you know, ever communicate. So I have to be intentional about calling my mother and saying, hey, mom, how you doing? I love you. I'm thinking about you. You know, let's go have something to eat. Let's go to the mall. Let's go to the store. What am I doing? I'm being intentional about making that connection with her so that she doesn't get so used to being by herself, even with my children sometimes. And I know I get on their nerve, but I go and I knock on the door. I'm talking about my grown children that live in the house with me. I go and I knock on the door. Hey, how you doing? Come out of this room. Let's have a conversation. Let's talk. What you dealing with? What's going on? We haven't talked for 3 days. What's happening? Are you depressed? Is something going on? Who's talking to you? Who's impacting your life? Let me give you another way to think about it. What am I doing? I'm communicating with my family and I'm establishing lines of communication so that they know that it's safe to talk to me. It's safe, you know, you can trust me. And so then what do? We provide insights on solutions or situations for our family. A lot of family members, they disagree about how they should deal, you know, with their personal problems. And while it can be difficult to hear, you know, sometimes you have a family member sharing things from their perspective. One of the things that my husband said that he was going to do when, as our kids were getting older, and even when they were in their teens, is he said, Melva, we got to adapt the poker face mentality. And I'm like, what is that? Because I was that mom that took everything personal, you know, and today my kids tell me that I play the victim, but really what it is that when my kids get in something, I'm like, oh my God, what did I do that you don't see it the right way, you know? And it's like, you didn't do anything. These were their choices and they're living their life the way that they want to live their life. And so my husband said to us early on, adapt a poker face. What does that mean? It doesn't matter what they say to you. Look like nothing that they say will surprise you. So you just keep staring at them as they're talking and you're like, And it could be like a vice, something just gripping your heart, the things that they're saying to you. And it's like, oh my God, on the inside, but your face can't show that, you know? And I'm guilty of allowing my face to show up and my emotions to show up when things are going on with my family, you know? And so my husband said, you're gonna have to adapt a poker face mentality. And so you just listen. And even if you don't agree, you listen, because the moment your facial expressions or the moment you say something and you don't let them talk, you don't let them finish, you're gonna lose your opportunity to be able to speak into their life. And I'm talking about all family members. And so what you wanna do is stay in a place where you can speak into their life. But to do that, you're gonna have to hold on to your seat and just sit there and be like, oh my God. Oh my God, on the inside, but on the outside, it's like, okay. All right. You know, and so now what I've started doing is while they're talking on the inside, I'm saying, God, give me the wisdom. Give me the words to say to them. When it's my turn to talk, please, Father, give me the wisdom to be able to hold my emotions so that I don't spew what I have to say on my kids. I want them to be able to see that I can handle whatever they may be going through. And I don't want anything that they tell me to catch me by surprise. And I don't want to act like it caught me by surprise. And so when you communicate well, it gives that other person the opportunity to make an informed decision about what's troubling them. And so problems occur when the different perspectives offend the family member, especially when it dramatically goes against what he or she believes. And so if this happens, it's best to share your perspective and then take a step back. Share your, well, here's how I feel about it. Here's what I think about it. Now you're asking me what I think about it. I'm going to share this. But then what you ultimately do, always leave your family members understanding that you understand that the ball is ultimately going to be in their court. Now, when we're talking about small children, that's a different subject. You know what's best as the parent and you share what's best and then you lay down the law. That's just the way it is. But when you're dealing with adults, it's a little more difficult. You know, it's your loved one's decision to take. You can't control people. And we have a lot of family members trying to control others. You can't control outcomes. That's not your job. Your job is to give wisdom to a situation and then step back. Remember what the word says. Paul said, I planted, Apollos watered, but it's God that gives the increase. And so sometimes we want to be the planter. We want to be the waterer, and then we want to be the one, you know, to dictate how it comes out. That's not your job. Your job is either to plant or it's to water and then step back and let God do what he does. You cannot control every outcome. Embrace that. Accept that. You may not like the way people are doing the things that they're doing. You may not like, you know, in my marriage, I'll share this with you all. In my marriage, there are decisions that my husband would make in the early days of our marriage, and I knew they were the wrong decision. And he's probably watching me, but I'm gonna say it. I knew they were the wrong decisions, you know, and, you know, trying to be that good little wife. I'm like, okay, y'all, this is not the right decision. And so what I would tell, you know, I was telling some women that I was counseling one time. So what did I do in those moments when I knew that he was gonna make the decision no matter what? I turned around to my kids behind me and I was like, y'all buckle up because this ship is going down. And so we all buckle up and we take the ride. But the whole time that we're going down, I'm saying, Father, protect us. Father, watch over us. Father, keep us. I know that this decision is not the right decision, but you told me to submit to him in everything. I'm trying to submit to him. I'm trying to do what you say. Now let your grace abound in my life. And I promise you, when we hit the ground, and we often did in the early days of our marriage, when we hit the ground, I would get up like, whew, thank you, Lord. And we would have to suffer the consequences of whatever it was, whatever the decision was. But we were all right. I'm like, okay, we got out of that. Thank you, Jesus. Kids, y'all all right? Yeah, we all right. Okay, well, let's go. Let's keep living. And so what do? He learned as everybody took the fall. We all took the fall with him. He learned that it's best to listen to reason, to get others' opinions, to talk to the family before a decision is made. And so what am I talking about? I'm talking about the importance of communication in your family. You know, and then here's another thing that happens with your family. It brings you all together and you form a tighter bond. Trusting in family members by communicating with every one of them, it fosters the love that you need to share, and then it tightens your bond together. I love it when I can sit and talk with my family. Now, there's times we just not seeing eye to eye, you know, but in those times, you know, we're always looking for that way to come back together. And we've had many difficult moments with our family unit, but families that communicate, even when it's hard, we always, you know, recently we had an experience where, you know, there was a challenge with my husband and my daughter. And it went on for about 2 weeks. And by the second week, I was like, okay, y'all, this is long enough. This is long enough. You all are not communicating. I can't have this. The devil is getting in here. We got to close this gap. And so what did we do? On Sunday, we sat down together as a family. We called the family. Everybody came in. They made it a priority. They know that when it's time to have the family, that is not a negotiable. If you tell me that you're available, I'll ask them, are you available at this time? And they say yes. I'm locking that time in. I take that time. And our family is committed. Remember, we said that there's that Geneva Code of Convention where there's certain things that cannot be done, but there's also certain things that must be done. And one of the things that must be done is when a family meeting is called, everybody has to commit to being there. And our kids have made that commitment. And some of them drag in like, oh my God, I got to listen to mom talk. I ain't trying to hear this. You know, we get all of that. But they come in. Some of them will come in like this, you know, with their hoods on and all of that. But it's, you're here. I appreciate you being here. We're going to get through this. You know, and as we're talking, tears start rolling, you know, because what do? We love one another. And we create a space for us to come in and begin to talk to one another. And as we're talking to one another, then we can see they really do love me. You know, and something that my kids said on Sunday that really blessed my heart is we know, both of them said it to us, we have no doubt in our mind that you all love us. We just don't agree with some of the things that you all say. We don't see things the way that you all see them. But we know that you love us, and that blessed me. Well, they're adults. You don't have to see things the way that I see them. But when it comes to my household, you're going to have to do what I'm asking you to do, or you got to get out. That's the bottom line. You know, that there's some non-negotiables. Yes, you can be your unique self. You know, my daughter, both of my kids are artistic. They're in the arts. And so you can be as artsy as you need to be. But here's the boundaries for your artsiness in my house. When you come in my house, these are the things that I'm looking for. And if you can't give me that, love you, I'll drive by. I'll come help you put your house together. But you're going to have to get out of my house. If you can't, as an adult, if you can't do what I'm asking you to do, you can't stay. And that's the resolve that we came to. And so it was all right, cool. Chest bump, high five, love you. We went our ways. But what did we do? We got rid of that fox that was trying to spoil the vine of our family. And so some of you have been allowing division to exist in your family way too long. Get a hold of it, because God is, you know, if it's scratching in your spirit, if it's bothering you, then you're the one, you're it. Tag, you're it. You're the one that God is saying, bring your family together. Close this gap. Stop allowing this. Even, well, they don't listen and they want this and they want that. That's okay. God knows all of that. And he will give you the grace to be able to deal with how they are. So you're going to have the grace. You know, sometimes things get really, you know, my son Kyle, he's just going to watch. He's going to listen. And sometimes I want to reach over and punch him in the chest, you know, when he acts like, whatever, mom, you know, I want to punch him. But I'm graced to deal with him. That's the thing that you've got to remember. If God puts you in that family unit, he will never put you someplace and not give you the grace to be able to live in it. And so you've got to understand that although it's hard in your mind and in your emotions, you have what you need to walk with that rebellious child, that flippant child, that child, that strong-willed, stubborn child, with that sister that just gets under your last nerve, with that brother that irritates you. You have the grace to deal with that. And when you can remember that I have the grace, that this relationship was created on a higher order, and that I can get through this, then I'm willing to give what I have. And even if it's rejected, I'm still going to do my part, because that's what God requires of me. I cannot run and hide from my relationships that God has given me. I cannot act like I don't have these kids and just ignore them and act like they don't exist. That's your daughter. That's your son. Even though you don't like what they're doing, they're yours. God gave them to you, and he's going to hold, you know, many people think that, you know, God holds them accountable for the things that they do in life. Well, Jesus has already made provision for the things that you've done in life. What God is going to hold you accountable for is what he told you to do, what he assigned you to do. That's where you're going to be held accountable, for the deeds that you do in your body that he told you to do while you're in the body. And if he gave you that daughter, if he gave you that son, then he also gave you the wisdom to be able to walk with them, so you have it. For every vocation, there is an equal allocation of grace to be able to walk out, live out, deal with whatever it is that you've got to deal with. So you've got to know that you're not by yourself in walking with your children, walking with your spouse, walking with your mother, your father, your cousin, your uncle, whoever it may be, whatever may be going on. You got the goods to bring your family unit together. And so I just believe that God is moving, you know, moving the church back to this place where it realizes that it's through you that the world is going to see God. And so when your family is strong and people can see that your family is strong, and it's more than just, you know, we take pictures with everybody on social media, but when was the last time you spotlighted your family? When was the last time you took a selfie with your family and showed the world, this is my family? We don't always agree. We don't always, here's a selfie of my family. This is my family unit. This is my company. These are the people that I love. We don't always agree again, and we don't see everything eye to eye, but I love them. They love me, and together we are heirs together of the grace of life. We're doing life together. God is blessing us. And when there's challenges in our family, we're communicating. We are committed to our life of communication. And so this is important. You know, a lot of families grow apart. And I'm going to close with this, because the individuals within the family become wrapped up in their individual lives and they forget to come to the home base. Don't forget the home base to talk about the world around you. You know, so then when problems come up, if you've established a strong communication base with your family, you'll feel as though your family is a safe place for you to seek shelter. That's the whole deal. When my husband comes home, I want him to know, you've been out there, whatever you've been doing out in the world, it will not compare with what you will experience when you come in here. When you come in here, you're going to be loved unconditionally. When my children come in the house, they're going to be loved unconditionally. So even though I may not like everything that they do, I love them. And it's important for me to always keep our home environment. That's why I was saying yesterday when my husband said that I'm the house band. I'm the one that bands around the house. Well, I band around this house too. Don't get it twisted. I'm here looking and keeping my eye on what's going on so that the culture in my household is one that's life-giving. See, the church is not supposed to be the only place that's life-giving. Your family unit, when people come into my house, they come in, they take their shoes off. That's why we make people, you know, it's not just to protect my floors, but we make people take their shoes off so you can know you take your shoes off when you go home. When you come in my house, you're coming home. And people come in my house and they don't want to leave. And there's times that we've had meetings that's gone on until late. Why? Because people love being in a place where there's peace, where there's love. And so your family needs to come home to an environment that's life-giving. Culture is the air, the environment in which something exists. And so make your family unit, your house, a culture, a place that your children, your cousins, your uncle, your mother, your father, your sister, your brother can come into and know, I'm going to be loved for who I am without my family stumbling over who I am not. God bless you all. I hope I said something today that has increased you. Our desire through Fresh Baked Manna Live is to say something that will build your life and your faith, you know, so that you can be a better individual than you were yesterday. That's what this is all about. It's about you growing and you being the best version of you that you can be. And so Fresh Baked Manna, our vision is to develop the life and faith of the believer worldwide, to get people living the John 10:10 life. Jesus said in the Amplified Bible that he came that you might have and enjoy life in abundance to the full until it overflows. That's the life that God wants for you and for your family. God bless you. Love you all. See you tomorrow. Bye-bye.